Before the year 1800, no European nation knew anything about the civilization known to us as ancient Egypt. The pharaohs were unknown. The mummies, the treasure, the temples, even the pyramids themselves, unknown. Several maps made before the year 1700 don't even depict any pyramids anywhere in Egypt, while the very same maps depict far less historically significant churches. Where were the pyramids that supposedly had been standing for 3,500 years? And why were they absent on pre-Columbian maps? To understand this is to understand that our westernized perception of ancient Egypt has been carefully molded by unscrupulous institutions of perverse knowledge. Everything that has been uncovered has been strategically packaged within a presupposed agenda and counter-agenda, neither of which resembles truth. Unpackaging the truth about the history of ancient Egypt first begins with accepting a new truth. America is Egypt. Running, 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 running.
I walk across high coals to show you my feet so you know I got soul. Top choice, underground rapper with the pop voice. They are not ready, they sweating, they not poised. I'm built for this, like pyramids. This is the shit kids put on their Christmas list. Everybody told me stay in my lane when they never took a trip to the place where I came from. Never saw the trees that my ancestors swang from. Never tried to understand where we got our slang from. Never felt the breeze of the slave master's whip.
We all know by now that America prior to 1492 had a thriving and by many accounts diverse population. Anthropological finds on the North American continent alone would seem something out of a Hollywood movie, from giants who stood over 10 feet tall to the oldest traces of civilization dated prior to the supposed bearing migration. The hidden truth about America is far stranger than the fraudster's fiction. But this movie wouldn't be complete without the villain, and the adversary playing that role is institutional academia in general. Of course, this mostly begins with the gatekeeper, like Harvard and the universities, the Smithsonian, NASA, the British Museum, the Louvre, the military, and every other institution connected with higher learning who promotes false, racist, historic propaganda. And that is especially what we are dealing with here. Pseudo-Eurocentric propaganda. Much of this propaganda is centered around transatlantic slave trade exacerbation and the institution of Darwinism within the world of science. Running hand in hand are these two theories, so intertwined within the psyche of Americans. All information surrounding these two insertions into the world's historic narrative serve as a breeding ground for the ignorance of the ages. Not only connecting a people to a land where they are not biologically from, but disconnecting those people from their ancestral homelands. This was all done through literature, as was the creation of ancient Egypt. A mythological location set like a movie in people's minds in the dry deserts off the Mediterranean coast. This location was chosen after the discovery of America as the stage for the new composite history of Mitzrayim. It is well known that hieroglyphics were unknown to any of the Western European powers before the supposed Napoleonic invasion. So, of course, that would also mean that Egyptian hieroglyphics were unknown to the Americans as well, correct? Because if American Indians had been using Egyptian script prior to the year 1500, and also after the year 1500, wouldn't that mean that the French discovery of hieroglyphics and the magical Rosetta Stone would be a complete lie, or at least a misrepresentation of the truth? The idea that the 1798 Egyptian campaign is what introduced the world to ancient Egypt would have been a total concoction. From the year 1605 to 1763, the French built several forts and colonies in Indian territory. Are we to expect that no exchange of phonetic or literary information took place in over 150 years? Now, most scholars will tell you that the American Indians had no written language. This fable serves dual purposes. One, to dismiss any pre-Columbian script as illegitimate or forgery. And two, this smokescreen serves as a prejudicial assumption to the position of Europeans toward the idea of Indian savagery. These schemes laid the bedrock for Manifest Destiny, and Manifest Destiny played an important role in the destruction of evidence. This point cannot be understated. The history of the American civilization prior to Europeans was systematically dismantled and suppressed, while at the same time, ancient Egypt was being created. Such a contradiction of philosophies in the preservation versus the destruction of ancient histories leads any logical determination of these actions to indicate historical conspiracy. The walls of the pyramids in Egypt were being meticulously studied while pyramids in the Americas were being eradicated. According to all historians, the fall of the Mississippian culture happens around the year 1500, approximately the same time of the first European contact. What happened to these people? The most prominent assertion put forward by academics is disease, most notably smallpox. Although modern forensic anthropologists now say it wasn't smallpox that killed the majority of American Indians, but rather salmonella. No matter what killed these people, the reality is the Indian nations who dwelt here were far more advanced than history will give them credit for being. Archaeoastronomy techniques that were used in Egypt at the pyramids of Giza had been well employed by the American nations for millennia. Hundreds of mound centers were measured with exact specifications, whether that be geometric or astronomical. In addition, the pyramids of Mexico and Central America are also built to these symmetrical specifications. Long before the idea of ancient Egypt was even known to the Western world, where could these people have gotten this knowledge? Way on the other side of the ocean, when their neighbors to the north had no idea. Billions of man hours contributed to the massive network of earthworks that once blanketed the valley of the Great River. At one point, it was estimated that there were over 200,000 mounds in the continental United States alone. And within these 200,000 mounds, some incredible things have been uncovered that these charlatan historians wish they could hide forever.
Thankfully, some artifacts in ancient cities yet remain, such as these once city walls, intentionally preserved as mounds in a golf course in Newark, Ohio.
I'm standing here at the parallel walls that connect the gigantic octagon with a large circle. The circle is 1,054 feet in diameter. The octagon encloses 50 acres, which is large enough to encompass four Roman Colosseums. This was built by the ancient Hopewell culture that lived in this region between about 100 BC and AD 400.
The level of precision, it is incredible.
The entire Newark Earthworks encompasses 4.5 square miles, and it was the largest complex of geometric earthworks ever built in the world. It includes two circles, a gigantic octagon, a square. But actually, what we call the Hopewell culture, things like it at least, and things related to it, covered much of eastern North America in different parts, as far south as Florida, as far east as far west as Kansas City, as far east as perhaps New York.
They had to be incredibly sophisticated to be able to build these mounds perfectly, you know, in unison to an octagon shape and a circular shape.
It's clear that they rival, by any scale, any other cultural achievement in the world, the Great Pyramids, the Great Wall of China, the Roman Colosseum.
I'm not that surprised by it. There's so many other things that we see when we start learning about and looking into native culture that I think people on the surface may be surprised, because they tend to think of Indian people as anti-intellectual or, you know, non-scientific or somehow, you know, living in the backwoods and not knowledgeable about things like that.
The knowledge embedded in these earthworks and encoded in their structure is anything but primitive. It's remarkable.
You know, it also shows that not just high math, but these sites are lined up primarily with the lunar calendar. They had high math, they understood geometry, and because of the lunar calendar, they also understood the heavens, astronomy.
What I've learned now is just how amazing they were in terms of their knowledge of the solar system and of mathematics.
And then they had the unit of measurement was 606, which they call the stade. One side of the Great Pyramid from the base to the tip of the apex is 606 feet. If you square inside the octagon, which the surveyors like to call, it's a term they use, squaring the circle, and you divide that up into four equal parts inside of cubes, you'll find those cubes are all made of 606 foot lines per cube side. The angle of the Great Pyramid of Egypt runs 51.8 degrees up the slope from the base to the angle. That measurement is there, and when you come off of the baseline at the Newark and you run true north and then measure that angle back to the baseline, what do we find? 51.8 degrees. So did they have the same math as the ancient Egyptians? Well, I gotta say, yeah, it sure looks like it.
Here we have an ancient tablet with some sort of script. I've heard many historians call this artifact fake, not because there is physical evidence supporting their case, but because Indians had no written language. Therefore, it is deemed counterfeit. It should be noted that the only school of thought where this artifact would be considered legitimate is if it falls under the notion that this tablet is not an original Indian artifact, but was instead left by Europeans who traveled to visit the Americas generations earlier. This gatekeeping mechanism is the indoctrinated thought that permeates the halls of academia and the psyche of anyone exposed to Western education. These people were savages without written language or record. It's probably one of the most bigoted assumptions of an entire people that is still being taught in colleges and universities today. So the accredited world of academia says this tablet is fake because Indians didn't write. But what happens when more tablets are found in different places with the same type script? Can the same argument be used to denounce their authenticity? Of course, the same argument could be used. But with each new discovery, that argument would weaken substantially to the point of an obvious cover-up.
This new direction would not only include racist ideas, but additionally, it would attempt to limit the use of some artifacts.
I'd like to next read from the following, J.W. Powell's own words. This is a paper that he presented to the members of the Smithsonian at the Bureau of Ethnology. And the title on the talk is On Limitations to Use of Some Anthropological Data. And it's pages 73 through 86 of the 1879 and 1880 book that was published in the Smithsonian. And the quote is as follows. Hence, it will be seen that it is illegitimate to use any pictographic matter of a date anterior to the discovery of the continent by Columbus for historic purposes.
Native Americans, even today, suffer from this policy, which effectively meant that Native Americans have no history.
You only have history if it's something written down. If you have an oral tradition, that doesn't count as history.
Part of the legitimating the conquest and dispossession and subordination of American First Nations is to disrespect their alternative ways of life, and that would include their systems of recording information.
Many believe that the Native Americans had no written record prior to Christopher Columbus. This would make it prehistory, but nothing could be further from the truth.
What you learn through ceremony has been taught and preserved on birch bark scrolls. Not like English is written in words, but there are pictographs that have been compared to, for example, Egyptian hieroglyphics. We do know that there are certain people who are charged with being the stewards of those scrolls and taking care of them, so they would have closer access to be able to look at and keep those scrolls.
Yet many still believe that Native Americans had no written language.
In fact, on the Department of Natural Resources website, you can see that it says, we have no idea who these mysterious people were who were creating these images. And yet, very clearly, our people, who are the traditional people of that area, we know exactly what those teachings are.
In fact, the Mi'kmaq have a written language that predates Columbus.
With a fully developed glyph system, you can say anything, the poetry, philosophy, technology, whatever, as one only has to go to China or Japan to see that their systems are the equal of any European writing system, but very different.
I don't know that everyone running around was creating scrolls and using those in the way we use language today, but it was still something that I think one person could create a scroll and another person would be able to read that had no connection to them.
What happened to these written records?
But it is another irony that we find that we're said to not have any kind of written language or history, and it's all stored in the shelves of the museums.
At every museum, small or big, has a great quantity of stuff that's boxed up that hasn't seen the light of day for literally 100 years.
That door in the Sphinx, does the library of that knowledge lie?
I think there is extraordinarily powerful evidence to suggest that this is so. If you were amongst the survivors of a high civilization, and you had been, your civilization had been destroyed in an enormous cataclysm, and you wanted somehow to keep the memory of your civilization preserved, and to pass down the knowledge to the future, and you might particularly want to do that if you believe passionately in the reincarnation of the soul, by the way.
Are these heathens covering transatlantic pre-Columbian contact or something more sinister? And why do these tablets resemble Greek or Coptic script? It's important to note that Coptic script is a mesh between Greek and Egyptian writing systems and was used in the interpretation of Egyptian hieroglyphs. Generally, Coptic script finds its roots during the rise of Christianity into Egypt. So why is Coptic being found in several locations in America? And even more importantly, why are depictions of Greek and Trojan military being carved into the same tablets. We can clearly see this as a depiction of a man in what looks like a Greek or Roman military helmet. From the look of this image, this man appears to be a Caucasian or European. But wait, there's more. Other depictions surface on tablets of similar character, as well as images that appear to be Negro, and more importantly, images that appear to be Egyptian. There's no mistaking the Egyptian theme behind these old relics, but if you ask any Egyptologist about these artifacts, they will call them crude forgeries. The Egyptians were symmetrical and perfect, as seen by the lovely murals on Egyptian temples. These are primitive and unrefined, claudish imitations. Moreover, these artifacts are deemed anterior to the discovery of the Americas by Columbus and therefore illegitimate as it concerns the classically established history of America. Unto this day, artifacts of the like are being held under lock and key in institutions like the Smithsonian and the magical disappearing Bonaparte Library, which was bigger than the Library of Congress. Ironically enough, this massive Bonaparte library possessed by Joseph Bonaparte, the guy who almost ended up being the first French-Mexican president, wasn't in Paris or Naples or London or even Egypt, but instead Bordentown, New Jersey. If they had acquired this library before 1800, why would they have taken every book they had ever acquired away from their established empires of Spain, France, and Naples, especially since Joseph Bonaparte moved back to France? Wouldn't it have been easier to have kept his library in France? Nonetheless, what exactly happened? The massive library suspiciously caught fire. A story that mirrors the fires at the Library of Congress and the Smithsonian. Interestingly, history doesn't recall the significance of these fires as it relates to the possible theft or destruction of momentous records of antiquity. When the French were colonizing Middle America, there is no doubt they came across Egyptian culture. There is no speculation about this patent fact.
Skeleton of a man, but also in this coffin was a little box, no more than maybe about 8 or 10 inches in size, and it was cemented shut. Wyrick and the men, while they're all there together, they pried this box apart, and in it was a black stone. They opened this box, and here was this unusual artifact.
We own the newer Coley stones, and these stones were found in a Hopewell mound in the 1860s, and the presumption from finding them was that perhaps the American Indians had some kind of contact with the Hebrews, or possibly they were the Hebrews. That's another idea. So we have the museum has been interested in origins.
They took it to some scholars identified that it was probably some type of Hebrew. They took it to some rabbis living in the area, and upon looking at it, they said yes, they could read it. And it was a complete rendition of the Ten Commandments. They called it block Hebrew because they had never seen anything written like this, but they called it block Hebrew. And so then naysayers started picking on Weyrich. He was accused of sticking this stone in front of these nine men somehow and being able to hide it and conceal it.
Upon examination, mainstream archaeologists proclaimed the stones a hoax, while many diffusionists continue to believe in their authenticity.
There has been good points on either side for whether they are a first millennium piece of artifact or something that was devised in the 19th century.
And then it wasn't until sometime in the 1900s, lo and behold, in Israel, they find, guess what? They found block-style Hebrew. That block-style Hebrew was given a name by the experts, monumental Hebrew, because of the way it was written, long after Weyrich. After.
Mainstream archaeologists dismissed such findings, in part because scientific protocols and rules of evidence were not followed in their acquisition.
The science of archaeology was really in its infancy at that time. There were only a few people using what we would consider to be even remotely modern methods.
But what of the tens of thousands of artifacts found prior to the establishment of these modern methods? Should we ignore these artifacts because they have been irreversibly separated from their original surroundings? But diffusionists like to point to one artifact that has been dismissed by mainstream archaeologists, even though it was found using modern methods within the original surroundings.
They can't say that about the Back Creek Stone, because the Back Creek Stone was found in the course of an official excavation by the Smithsonian Institution. Okay, then Back Creek Stone went to the Smithsonian Institution in Washington. They didn't understand it. They thought it was Cherokee, since it came from Cherokee country. They did not realize it was Hebrew. And they published it upside down, and then they threw it in a box in the sub basement of the Smithsonian. And ever after, it was poo-pooed until some Semitic scholars like Cyrus Gordon came and vindicated it.
Cyrus Gordon, who was one of the great Semitic scholars of our generation, he talks about the writings that were found in this very area and how he was able to translate those things, translate that writing. When it was turned over, they were trying to figure out what type of Native American wrote this, and Cyrus Gordon turned it upside down. He recognized that it was actually Phoenician.
Phoenician, this older form of Hebrew, dates to the Old Testament Babylonian captivity and the scattering of Israel. Are there other linguistic evidences that may lend support to diffusionist ideas?
As a scholar of ancient languages, I have discovered that there are many symbols in the Mi'kmaq that are very close and similar to those of ancient Egyptian. About 700 BC in Egypt, there was a language that was developed or came in that was called Meroitic from the kingdom of Meroe, which many Egyptian scholars have even called Reformed Egyptian because it's so different than what the standard Egyptian that we know. And this Meroitic is very close to some of those, the signs of the Mi'kmaq.
Anthropologists dismiss a lot of the stone evidence and inscriptions in these ancient languages like Egyptian and Greek and Hebrew by saying, well, they were not found in the course of an official excavation.
Are these diffusionist ideas simply a continuation of the controversies that existed in John Wesley Powell's day?
There were some people who were arguing that the mounds had not been built by any of the existing groups of North American Indians, and they would use the word race indiscriminately. There were others who did argue that no, these were non-Indian peoples in a biological sense, and that they were built by Europeans.
As many people know, maize or corn had not been introduced to the other side of the Atlantic until after the year 1500. Meanwhile, in the Americas, corn had been a staple food for thousands of years. This simple contradiction facilitates the philosophical split between Egyptology and biblical scripture. Why would Genesis mention corn when corn supposedly didn't exist in Old World Egypt? Most charlatan professors will explain this inconsistency away with something like, quote, "Over the years, the residents of the New World used the term corn for maize. All maize is corn, but not all corn is maize. Therefore, the King James Bible is not talking about our maize or corn at all. It's talking about different kinds of grain, specifically wheat, rye, or barley. It is New World citizens who have applied our maize to biblical corn." And this is a complete lie, manufactured by con artists, academics who promote deception for their wicked overlords. These heathens bank on your ignorance and your apathetic unwillingness to investigate. Even the concordances are untrustworthy, conveniently leaving out specific verses that don't vibe with their New World theories. But the fact remains unchanging. The corn mentioned in the Bible over 100 times within context is exactly what we know as maize, and not wheat, barley, or rye. The fashioning of corn into different ways of eating has been an unchanging staple in Egypt from ancient times unto this day. This simple inconsistency in natural history is easily challengeable and researchable for the purposes of witnessing for yourself the levels of desperation that these people will create in order to misinform you. Corn has fed this earth during times of famine, not barley nor rye. Besides modern Egypt, is the 60th in barley production and number 18 in corn production. The state of Illinois alone produces more corn than the entire country of Egypt. Ironically, that's also where most of these Egyptian artifacts were found, in a place called Little Egypt. Coincidence? Deuteronomy 33:28. Israel then shall dwell in safety alone. The fountain of Jacob shall be upon a land of corn and wine. Also his heavens shall drop down dew. Now it's time to start asking simple questions. And the most important question, what else? What else are they hiding under their academic veil of secrecy? If Egyptian artifacts have been found up and down the Mississippi Valley in the 1900s, what were the French discovering in the 1600s? Better yet, what were the Spanish discovering in the 1500s? The Mississippian and Mayan civilizations had undeniable ties to one another. They both resembled elements of ancient Egypt, long before the world even knew what ancient Egypt actually was. It was only after this than did the French learn anything about these people or this culture. It goes beyond saying 3,500 years ago, during the supposed height of the Egyptian Empire. Empires in America, especially in the Mississippi, were flourishing and well advanced.
This idea of the different races not only having separate creations, but perhaps they also had different capabilities. That's where that played into it, because, you know, it's a small step from there to start talking about allegedly superior or inferior races, and that's exactly what happened.
Science did tell them that there were certain races that were superior and some that were inferior.
There seem to be two traditions in our culture with respect to acknowledging the accomplishments of our predecessors. The first is manifest destiny, flowing westward out of New England and New York and Philadelphia. From Plymouth Rock onward, we are fated to progress across the continent, driving the savages before us, and we are going to redeem this place from barbarism.
This classic study on manifest destiny and then Roger Kennedy's application of it to understanding and accepting American antiquities just is a very obvious pattern.
The obvious pattern was that discoveries of antiquities conflicted with the thinking of European immigrants, that Native Americans and their ancient ancestors were mere savages.
The doctrine of manifest destiny allowed the United States government to classify the Native Americans as savages by their terminology, and by calling them savages, that would allow them to push them aside and basically claim their lands as America expanded in a westward direction.
19th century Americans would have found it more than inconvenient. Politically, it would have been impossible for them to have taken lands away from Indians, from any indigenous peoples, if they viewed them as having rights even close to what they had as American citizens.
As the archaeology developed as a new science and anthropology as a new science, and they would find these things, these evidences to show that there was a written language, that these people possibly did smelt iron, they did smelt copper, and they mined it, they carried it, trade over great distances. These were signs of a higher civilization. And that higher civilization idea or theory coming from our educated scientific community of the day became directly in conflict with the manifest destiny ideas put forth by the U.S. government.
It is hard to truly get a scope on what exactly these prosperous civilizations used to resemble. All we have to go by now are the reformulated artist renditions, which are not always historically consistent based upon physical evidence. One of the most significant pieces of undeniable physical evidence are the mounds themselves. Not only are these mounds massive works embedded within the earth, they are indications of remarkable geometry compounded with an exceeding mastery of cosmology and mathematics. These are not primitive people by any stretch of the imagination. Their chiefdoms were masterpieces of humanity and nature, much of what has been attributed to Europeans was invented long before their travels across the sea. The earthworks built by these civilizations are by far the most slept-on natural wonders of the ancient world, and the only true pyramids still standing. Speaking of pyramids, several Mississippian locations predate the illustrious pyramids of Giza. Although they have been speculated to be older, reliably dating these monuments has been troublesome for those relying upon the extremely unreliable process of radiocarbon dating. However, for scientists, dating the oldest mounds doesn't prove as troublesome because the Earth interior is organic matter within the strata, and the process of aging is more consistent through the source material, which means it's easily proven Watson Break mounds are older than the pyramids of Giza. The quote by M. Perez still rings true. The amazing blunder of mistaking mythology for history. Conversely, just as blunderous would be to assume mythology has no true historical context. This mythology would have to include the histories of the Greek and the Egyptians. Is there any reason to assume their mythologies aren't truth? We can see for ourselves the accounts from the past have gone through several languages, revisions, and most importantly, millennia. How could the context of these things not have been changed? The truth is consistently at battle with the conqueror's agenda, and at the top of that agenda is concealing the identity of the true indigenous American.
Perhaps DNA science can settle once and for all the biological question of who, for example, the Hopewell Mound Builders were.
We can use DNA to help us reconstruct the past and the history of different populations because your DNA is passed down from your parents from generation to generation. There are certain types of DNA in particular that are very useful for reconstructing population prehistory. Your mitochondrial DNA is DNA that every person has, and you inherit it from your mother. Your mother passes it on to her children. Men don't pass it on to their children. And this type of DNA, therefore, gives us a measure of matrilineal relatedness. I collected DNA from, and analyzed DNA from a couple of different Hopewell Cemetery populations. When we looked at DNA from these two different Hopewell populations from Illinois and Ohio, we found that there were five primary mitochondrial DNA lineages present. These lineages have become designated by letter names in the scientific world. And the ones that we see in Native American populations, both living today and in these Hopewell cemeteries, were the mitochondrial lineages A, B, C, D, and X. And these five lineages are ones that are common today in Native Americans, and they were the ones that were present in these ancient Hopewell communities.
This is the way these heathens disguise their tomfoolery in a jambalaya of unseasoned Caucasian GMO rhetoric.
Populations in particular, peoples who live in the upper Great Plains.
You can tell by her panting breath she's nervous because she knows she's got to concoct a bowl of Chef Boyard bull feces. In her labored monologue about DNA evidence taken from the mounds, she essentially disguises the truth in coded phraseology. She first says that mitochondrial DNA taken from bodies within the mounds is only in 3% of today's so-called Native Americans. Then later she goes on to say that the DNA taken from the mounds isn't European or Asian. Now you can tell she's scared. So if it's not European or Asian, what is it? She knows she can't answer that question directly. She has been sworn to academic secrecy. If she doesn't disguise this answer, she can kiss her career goodbye. The evidence clearly shows the so-called Negro mislabeled as African has been in America far longer than in Europe, Asia, or Africa.
They can't stop us. We ain't sparked them wars up. We ain't start that famine. We ain't shot those cannons. What the fuck are y'all planning? We don't preach that hatred, we hold our shit sacred. We don't poison water, and our boys ain't in office. And we ain't stuffed in ballot boxes. We might get obnoxious, but it's unconscious. See, we came from stardust, and now it's all rust. We ain't polished, we ain't running auctions. We ain't build plantations, we ain't invade nations. But we slave for sensation, it's more important than our salvation. So it's downgraded, and we out here racing and chasing. Chase, chase. Can't stop us though.